So that was recorded, and the governor, in his journal and his amateur archaeologist, he wouldn't make up stories, I'm sure. So this is the first validation. And then the second one is this wood. This wood here, we believe it's from a Portuguese caravel, which was described in the 19th century in a local newspaper as the mahogany ship. It's a caravel and it's Portuguese. So that's the other evidence that the Portuguese explored that coastline. Now, and the other thing is about this bracelet, is the 16th century manufacture. This is classic 16th century manufacture for goldsmiths. And we'll look a little bit into this. So why shouldn't the Portuguese have been there? Because in 1522 there's the Treaty of Tordesillas, and that is where Spain and Portugal divided up the world. On one side is Portuguese and one side was Spanish. Now the eastern coastline of Australia is on the Spanish side. Okay? So the Portuguese should not have been there. So we think we'll go to our map now. We have to do a little bit of geography. This is my map of the world, and what we can see is that, very importantly, there is the 129th meridian. This is the 129th meridian. This is that demarcation, and on this side, this is the Spanish side, this is the Portuguese side. This is from the Treaty of Tordesillas. So here is the Australian coastline. And this is called the Shipwreck Coast here. Now, the thing is that Captain Cook, he was the main British explorer of Australia. And they believe that he used Dieppe maps. He used maps. And then the theory is that these maps were copied from Portuguese maps. Because there's things like, in the map that Captain Cook used, it was called, parts were called this part here. Captain Cook called this Botany Bay. But in the Dieppe maps, it's called the Costa de Barge. Some more evidence. Okay, so what we're going to do, we're going to have a look at what happened. So here we have Lisboa. In Portugal, and so Vasco da Gama in 1498 traveled around Africa and went to Goa in India. Now, the theory is he then returned to Lisboa, but the theory is that some of his ships, maybe one or two ships, continued on, and maybe. Where is this Geelong, where the Geelong Keys were found? So, we don't know. But some of them did continue on and they brought back spices and brought other things from the east. But maybe they brought jewels. Maybe they brought... That's the job of the Grand Deep. Did all the ships return or did some continue further east? Return later with even more jewels. Is bracelet Java Le Grandi one of those jewels? So in 1498, Vasco da Gama set sail from Lisboa. He left behind his sister, a giddy maiden, and his brother, who liked dressing up and being Santa Claus most of all. So the sailors, were they shipwrecked? Did they play games in the sand with their kids? Did they find a kangaroo or two? Both of these caskets are in the Archaeological Museum in Lisboa. There is very similar filigree wire work in these caskets as in bracelet, jarl, or brandy. So, immediately the question is, the goldsmiths, the authors of these wonderful superb pieces, are they also the authors of bracelet, jarl, or brandy? This is a very, very important question. Or, was bracelet, jarl, or brandy made in the same workshop? Does the mid-16th century manufacturer of bracelet jarl and brandy identify same authorship with the copter of Rotocaria? This is early 16th century, the other one is late 16th century, and yet bracelet jarl and brandy we think is sort of mid-16th century. So it's a curious, it's very hard to pin the date exactly. If you look at the manufacturer, this is Orthodox silversmithing of the 16th century, European 16th century. And so there is granulation and there is solder, there is a solder system that's of the time. And beaded wire, this is swaged wire. It's just so typical of that 16th century. This beaded wire began by the Greek period, but this developed after the Roman period, but from the 16th century, this is classic beaded wire. Granulation work, and so that's the manufacture, this wire construction work. Now, so what about the alloy? What about the silver, the alloy? So we did analysis of bracelet, jarl, or brandy, and the alloy suggests typical quality of silver that was used in the 16th century European silversmiths. So, why was there a policy of secrecy? You see, you can imagine the Portuguese sailors, they go down the eastern coast of Australia, they map it, and that becomes the Dieppe maps. One ship gets shipwrecked, it wasn't the Sandy, Geelong. They go back, they take the maps back to the King of Portugal, and this is not to be public, this is secret information, because this could create a political problem with Spain. And so there is a secrecy. A policy of secrecy explains the silences together with the destruction of records in the Lisbon earthquake of 1755. And so a lot of government records were lost. So maybe bracelet, jarl, and brandy is the only material evidence. Does relocating bracelet, jarl, and brandy with other Indo-Portuguese artifacts in the National Museum of Art in Antigua, and as well provide the missing link? So is there anything in the Antiquities Museum in Lisbon that might be able to give us light? Does the iconography of the filigree work and its stylistic configuration of the bracelet jarl or brandy identify same maker or workshop? This is what we consider. This is still a possibility. Or is it the use of same stylistic references by more than one maker? And that's the thing. Was bracelet jarl or brandy made in the same workshop? Or are they looking for someone else at that time is copying the tabernacles they're copying, that's the fashion or the trend of filigree work of that time. We're not sure.